Illinois is jacking up its taxes, and neighboring Indiana's Governor Mitch Daniels calls them dysfunctional. And while we're at it, federal fiscal policy in Washington looks a little dysfunctional, doesn't it? Well, let's hear what potential presidential candidate and Indiana Republican Governor Mitch Daniels has to say about all of it. He joins us now for an exclusive interview. Governor, before we begin, welcome back, by the way, to the show. Before we begin, really the hottest topic out of Washington tonight is Hu Jintao and China's red arrogance rising, its unfair trade practices. Something I asked Donald Trump about last night. I want you to please take a listen.
I know China very well. I have Chinese and have had Chinese partners. Believe me, you have to be very sharp and very smart to outwit them. And they are totally outwitting this country. They are outwitting our leaders. And it's a very, very sad situation.
All right, Governor, you, I believe the state of Indiana has done business with China or was trying to do business with China. And a lot of people, including myself, are complaining, violating trade practices, software pirating, intellectual property rights pirating, counterfeiting. There's no end to it. What should we do about this China story?
If you sit where I do, Larry, you go over and try to repatriate some of those dollars we've been sending over there, bring them back here and my case, put Hoosiers to work. We signed one big deal this week to bring foreign direct investment in and got a verbal commitment to another today. Yesterday. I had lunch today with 200 Chinese business people and Chinese Americans interested in more mutual trade. My own view about the national situation is that, sure, they're not playing by the same rules, and this ought to be brought to their attention at every opportunity, but our problems, economic problems, are mainly self-inflicted. We better get busy cleaning up our own house. Lecturing them from a position of weakness won't do much good.
I want to come back to that because I think it's a great point. But if you were sitting in Washington in a larger office, hypothetically, is there something we could do? Is there something you might do to really develop a level playing field? You know, lots of American businesses are up in arms, including small businesses, especially this Chinese counterfeiting stuff. Would there be one action that you could possibly take?
Well, I don't think going to a mercantilist policy of our own, admittedly, they practice it in certain ways. I just don't think it's a winning game for us, Larry. You know, the very low-wage jobs that have migrated there would not come here, in my opinion, if suddenly their economy ran into trouble or we began blocking exports from there. No, I honestly think the most important thing we could do and say to them as our biggest creditor in the world is we're going to clean up our act and we're going to be good for our debts and we're going to put this economy on a growth footing for the long term so that your number one customer is still in a position to buy all that stuff. And if we do that, maybe we can have a little more mutual conversation about their misbehavior.
You and I both worked for President Reagan, and he famously said that national security, international security, relative to the Soviet Union and the Cold War then, could only be solved by economic growth security at home to make America great. We were kind of on our knees back then. We may not be on our knees right now, but the Chinese don't have much respect for our economy. What would you do there on that front?
Larry, I think you know better than anyone how urgently the United States needs to get on a sustained growth track on a level we haven't seen in many, many decades to have a chance of paying the bills that we have or to bring employment vitality back to this country. I think it means, first of all, that starting with a very direct and bold action against our accumulated debts. This means reform of the entitlement programs, means a dramatic downsizing of government, which I hope will start this spring, maybe using the leverage of this debt ceiling measure that they need so badly. You know, it means a pro-growth tax system lower and flatter, as low and flat as can be achieved. It means a completely different outlook toward regulation, which is choking the very growth which the president and his other advocates of big government need more than anybody.
Which is more important, cutting spending or the tax reform, and particularly the corporate tax cuts that businesses large and small are clamoring for?
I'd start with spending. Spending is the biggest problem, we'll need to move on both the spending and the pro-growth fronts, but I think the world is waiting, Americans are waiting for a signal that we're not going to continue spending our way over Niagara Falls as we are now.
I want to ask you about corporate taxes in Indiana. I know you're kind of licking your chops when Illinois made the mistake of jacking up their whole tax structure. But if I'm not mistaken, your corporate tax rate, about 8.5%, is actually higher than Illinois' new tax rate. Have you attempted, considered dropping the corporate tax rate, make Indiana an even better place for business?
You bet. And I think we're going to get it done this spring by swapping it out with some more narrow tax preferences that have encrusted in our law over the course of time. Now, all in, this is one of the most affordable states in America. We are two-thirds less expensive per job than Illinois, and that's before their new taxes take effect. So you do have to look at everything, the whole range of taxes. Our workers' comp is a third of theirs. Our property taxes are a fifth of theirs. And but, you know, we never stop trying. And, yes, I do want to see our corporate tax rate also come down to a very low level like our others are.
And finally, sir, you're scheduled to speak at the CPAC, the Conservative Political Action Committee. Some conservatives are raising a ruckus because you told the Weekly Standard that it's time to have a truce on social issues. So they're up in arms about right to life and traditional marriage and so forth. Can you explain your position on that?
Sure. I mean, first of all, our record's clear. You don't have to listen to what I say. We've been, we're in complete agreement, I think, with these folks on the positions they take. The only point I've made is I think our nation faces one overriding transcendent threat right now. If we don't deal aggressively with the debts that we've accumulated and that we're headed for, then all our other problems are going to look pretty secondary. If we go broke, we'll all suffer together. And so all I'm saying is that I sometimes tell audiences, if a foreign army was massed at the Canadian border, we'd all drop what we were doing, forget our other disagreements for a little while, and go try to repel it. And I just hope that we get a similar sense of national urgency and a very broad consensus, Larry. We're going to have to do the things that need doing, touch all the third rails, make fundamental changes in these social welfare programs. We're going to need a very broad consensus of Americans. And all I'm saying is, let's, for a moment, make that our first priority.
All right, Governor Mitch Daniels, we thank you for your time, sir. Good luck on everything.
See you, brother.